Here is how the left side crankcase looks before all the cleaning work. And here is how the left side crankcase should look after all the work, almost like new. My name is Bharat. Welcome to the channel. Hope you all are doing well. Just a small disclaimer before I begin. This is more of a documentary video than a tutorial because this is about me doing the things I learned online for the first time in real life to restore this crankcase, this left one. I'm not an expert and I have absolutely zero experience when it comes to engine rebuilds and stuff. So I got some broken parts of an RX engine from the scrapyard. Of course, these don't look like they came off a scrapyard, but this is after the cleaning job, so they are still broken, they just look nice, that's all. So I got these to learn the process, so when the time comes for an engine rebuild for my 1997 Yamaha RXG, I'd have the lessons, the knowledge and the experience of this particular work of cleaning and prepping the crankcases for reassembly. With that said, so the one on top is your right side crankcase. I've done all the work off camera for this one, and as you guys can see, it looks very nice and clean. The one that's sitting right below is your left side crankcase. This is what I'm going to do today. So there is a lot of leftover gasket material which was used by the previous mechanic who rebuilt this engine at some point of its life. So I need to scrape off all the gasket material, make sure that the mating surface is perfectly clean. Another thing is that all three bearings are completely jammed up, seized up, so they won't move. So I need to remove all these three bearings without damaging the case. Same goes for the oil seals that are present. And finally, clean it up nicely and polish it up for a nice brushed aluminum finish, just like how the right side crankcase looks. I begin the work by using a pen knife to scrape off all the leftover gasket material from the mating surface. For making this job easier, I did use some paint thinner, which I thought would weaken the gasket. I repeated using the Scotch-Brite pad, which was dipped with the thinner, and kept applying on the places to help with the gasket removal. But it didn't do much. So I'd suggest using a gasket remover or dissolver spray, which is built for that purpose. Link is down in the description box below. It makes the job a lot easier. As you guys can also see, I kept repeating the process many times so that I can be extra sure with the gasket removal work. Of course, I had to be very careful with the blade. Doing it bare hands is not a very bright move, but yeah, thankfully I did not hurt myself in the process. So yeah, the gasket has been removed. So I'm not sure what the previous mechanic has done, but what I think is that he has applied the sealant and then placed a gasket and then applied the sealant and then he placed the right side crankcase. So you have so many stuff going around here. The problem with doing that is that when you press on these sealants, they'll smudge around and go inside. All these white spots that you guys can see on the sides of the inside and the outside of the case, these are all the residues of the gasket sealant material. It could be, I think, anabond or whatever, but anyways, this is not supposed to happen, so we have to get rid of that as well, especially in the top portion. This is not carbon, by the way, this is the sealant, unfortunately. Yeah, so this entire portion was due to the sealant. The same was done for the cylinder gasket as well, the base gasket. It applied sealant and then placed the gasket and then applied sealant again and then placed the cylinder. So it's a complete screw up. I'm still gonna use the pen knife, so this thing would be very useful to cut through those things and get rid of those old gasket, the sealing materials. So let me get that done now. Okay, so almost all those excessive sealant which has dropped on the sides inside has been removed, almost, because you guys can still see a little bit of this still present here. Yeah, I've used some thinner and then I just use a Scotch-Brite to rub it off. And then this is a major work next. We have to clean the place where the crankshaft sits and make sure it is clean and spotless. So that's the next job. And now we have to get back to the outside of the case. As you guys can see, it's completely filthy. So this is the bottom, this is the side, and yeah, we have not even covered this side. And then here's the top. As you guys can see, there are some gasket material on the outside of the casing too, so that too needs work. So now let me clean up the exterior, make sure all of this is taken off, do the same gasket removal job on the exterior of the case. It looks like the gasket material is super good in making dust and dirt stick to it. So I cleaned it with a pen knife, and also at the bottom part, which was ridiculously bad, completely covered up with filth. God knows what it is, something probably worse than the corona itself. So yeah, that job was done as well, as you guys can see. Here you guys can see me use the brass brush. I cleaned up the surface and used some thinner again, and then removed all the grease and stuff. It was very useful and yeah, helped a lot. I quickly got an advice to keep the case over a piece of cloth to avoid any scratches or damages. So I did that and brushed off the remaining dirt and stuff using a brass brush and a normal soft paint brush. Alright, so after a long time of work, this exterior part is a bit clean. Again, I'm not exactly entirely happy with how it has turned out, so further work would be required, but this is how it looks. So let it, you guys can see the sides. So all the extra unnecessary gasket materials have been removed. That's a little difficult to do it with one hand. Oh, this underside was a complete mess. So that required a lot of work. So, but now it looks a lot better. So we have to remove three oil seals. There's one here, and there's one here. I'm just going to use a normal screwdriver to remove it. Judging by importance, I started with the most important one, the crankshaft oil seal, but had no success. So I moved on to the sprocket oil seal and the smaller oil seal, which came off easily. I had to come back to the crankshaft oil seal, and I still kept trying my best with at different angles and different forces, but nothing helped. The problem with this oil seal being so difficult to remove is that the previous mechanic, whoever had worked on this thing, has applied some sealant around the oil seal, so it's stuck inside, so it's a little difficult to remove. I'm afraid of damaging the cases anymore. So what I did with the flathead is just I cleaned the sides up, and now I'm going to try removing the oil seal again. A rather jugaad but an easy way that I found for this stuck oil seal is to slot the flathead of the screwdriver in between the oil seal and the bearing. And what you can do is you can twist or turn the screwdriver clockwise. This pushes the oil seal upwards and out, which helps in removing it out of the case with ease. Yeah, finally the bearing oil seal popped out. So as you guys can see, all the three oil seals are here. So now the thing is, it looks pretty bad actually. Hope you guys can see that. Looks very dirty, and this portion is damaged as well. So the next job is bearing removal. Usually what people do after removing the oil seal is they'll keep a socket that's of the correct size, which will sit on the bearing without touching the aluminium casing, and then they'll use a hammer and hammer it out. I'm not saying that it is a wrong method, but I've seen better methods, and one such better method is to use a heat gun. So what we do here is that we heat up the sides where the bearing sits on top of the aluminium casing. So here along the side, and here along the side, and here along the side. As you guys know, heat causes metal to expand, and there are different rates of expansion, speed of expansion of different metals. This casing is made up of aluminium, and the bearing is made up of chromium steel. But the good thing for us is that aluminium heats up faster and expands faster than the bearing. So this means that when we heat this up, it will expand, and then there is more space between the bearing and the case. So the bearing would simply fall off, as there is nothing to hold it tightly. So this is the method that we're going to do. Why this is a better method is that, number one, you're not using a hammer for this method. In the more common hammering method, if you accidentally slip, you have a chance of hitting and breaking the case. And this case is very expensive. You don't get them new. You have to get these from scrap. So in this method of heating up to remove the bearings, you don't need to use much force. And the best thing is that you don't need to use a hammer to do so. All you need is a rubber mallet, as you guys can see. This is made up of rubber. So you can do gentle taps, and the bearing would simply fall off after you heat up the areas of the aluminium casing that are holding these bearings. So let's start with the bearings. These two bearings, if we heat it up here and here and hit it, it will just fall inside. We can lift the case up and remove the bearings. This bearing though, we have to invert the case and hit it from that side, so it will fall off from here. So that's the job. Let's get these two done first, and then let's get this one done last.
So I have my heat gun and I have worn these normal gloves. These help me to avoid any serious burns. In this heat gun you have two different levels of heat. The first one is about 250 degrees Celsius and the second one is about 550 degrees Celsius. And the amount of air it flows is same for these two. The first one is about 250 liters of air per minute and the second one is about 550 liters of air per minute. We are going to take things slowly. We are going to heat up in the first level for a minute and then the second level for a minute. Guys, also we be very careful. This is extremely hot and it can cause a fire. So if you have cleaned this case up, make sure it's completely dry. It does not have any of the thinner or petrol or whatever that you used to clean that is flammable in any way. So because this can start a fire, so be very careful with that. Alright, and you know, wear some sort of gloves. Definitely something better than mine. This is all I had for now, so I'm going to use this. Okay Google, set a timer for 2 minutes.
For the heat settings, I learned that it's better to heat it up at full speed from start for 2 minutes instead of doing it gradually, as this causes the aluminum to expand quicker without being able to transfer too much of that heat to the bearing. So even if some of that heat gets transferred to the bearing and it also does heat up by a bit, it shouldn't get that hot as fast as the aluminum case, so it won't expand as much.
Let's turn it up. Yeah, so we have to be quick now.
Another blunder that I did is using a screwdriver's plastic handle instead of a metal socket, as I did not have the latter. So as you guys can see, I had no success whatsoever. So after that failure, I used a 14mm T-spanner and it worked much, much better. But again, it's much better to use a socket, so I have ordered a set from Amazon to help me in the future.
As you guys saw, the bearing simply popped off. A screwdriver tip didn't work, but I just simply used the 14mm and then I simply slightly tapped all the sides and the bearing simply popped off. Let's take a look at that junked bearing now. This is how the bearing looks like, pretty screwed up, doesn't move at all. It's completely jammed or seized up. This has to go to the trash. Now let's try this bearing. Same way, let us heat it up for 2 minutes and then see how it works. In this case, we need to invert the case. We can simply heat it up and it will simply fall off. That's what I think. Let's see. Okay Google, set a timer for 2 minutes. Yeah, so 2 minutes is over. Let me quickly switch the timer off. Placing the 14mm T. Gently hammering it. That took nothing, as you guys saw. I was simply hammering like this with my hand close to the mallet. So that took literally nothing. Let's take a look at the bearing now. Oh, it looks horrible. No matter how many other times of cleanup, bearing is also very hot because I use the heat gun. Even if I am deflecting away, the heat will still get there. But the difference in expansion is what caused the bearing to loosen up and fall right away. But as you guys can see, this bearing is also completely locked up. So yeah, again, all to the trash bin. The last bearing is this one. There's a bearing right here. Hope you guys can see that. Yes, this one. Let's remove that one as well. I'm seeing quite a lot of smoke from the case, but I'm not sure if you guys can see it as well. But yeah, it's the leftover that's smoking off, the leftover thinner which I used to clean this up. Oops, the bearing fell out. Hey, please. Yeah. Hope you guys can see it. Yeah, this one is also gone. Have to throw in the trash. But yeah, no bearings. All the bearings have been safely removed, as you guys can see. No damage to the case during this process. And so, yeah. Now we can thoroughly clean this case, you know, now that everything is out, all the oil seals, the bearing, everything is out, we can thoroughly clean this case up. So another thing is, don't be an idiot like me, you guys. What you can do is you can buy two small wood planks so that the case would sit something like this, and then you can heat the surface and then slightly use a mallet and tap it, especially this bearing, because this is a mating surface, so it will stay flat, you know, without these levels here, it will stay flat. But this place, this will not stay flat. As you guys can see, this is staying flat, but this will not stay flat. So, hope you guys can see that. So, hammering it here will cause the case to just keep moving away. So, what you guys can do is you can use a small plank, a wood plank like this, and then hammer it. I do not have a wood plank with me, so what I did is I used a small old paintbrush, and then I simply slid under this area. So hope you guys can see that. So now I have to clean these bearing surfaces. We have to use a Scotch Brite again and then gently clean it up. I've used some thinner of course to loosen up the dirt and the rust. So let's get that done now.
I thought of simply using a Dremel tool with a Scotch Brite bit and letting it rip to rotate at very high speeds, which would help in cleaning it up, but I was advised against it. So I'm doing that manually. Now that everything is out, there are still many nooks and corners with deep pockets in this crankcase which are difficult to clean with hand. So the best way is to use a bucket of surf water. It's an excellent detergent and a degreaser. Alright, so the surf water has been filled to the brim and I have my engine casing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to submerge it fully inside the bucket, because the good thing about it is that you know, surf is an excellent degreaser. So the grease that I'm not able to see during the cleaning process, that would simply come loose and then would come off. A good thing about this is that I have a semi-automatic washing machine, so I can save a lot of water this way. This is water that's coming off the clothes that have already been washed. So I'm simply going to reuse this water for cleaning this case. So as you guys can see, fully went in. So it will sit there for an hour or two. After that, I'll take it out and then clean it up and polish it.
The next day.
So this is actually the next day. I immersed the crankcase for a long time because I had some work and I completely forgot about the fact I had to take it out in an hour. So let's take this out now. Already it's a lot cleaner. Let's rinse it up now and then oops, you have to be very careful with this aluminium casing, it's not that strong, you know, and it's difficult to do this with one hand because it's not that light either. Yeah, so it's a lot cleaner now. Help me get this in and let me dry this up.
The next job is to polish this case and have a nice bright shine look to it. So this is the underside. As you guys can see, this is not in a good shape. Once after all the cleanup, everything is clearly visible. It's broken here, and you guys can see this mounting hole where the magnet cover sits. This one is also bent, and then a lot of scratches here and there. All the threads of these are gone. We have to get that rethreaded. And inverting the case over, it looks pretty good. This black stuff that you see here is actually oxidization. Yes, aluminium can rust too, and this is the form of rust that you see on aluminium. Since it was submerged in all sorts of crap, God only knows what. And also after cleaning, many gasket material is still left over, you know, the dirt had covered it up. So soaking it in soap water or surf water was very beneficial in showing back up the things that I have not removed. Like there are areas here where there is still a little bit of gasket material. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna polish it up for now. I've ordered a gasket cleaning solvent that will help in cleaning this one, which is more made for this purpose alone. So after polishing the thing, I'll spray that gasket remover fluid and then redo the gasket work. So yeah, let's start the polishing process from outside. So this area looks pretty good, but everything within doesn't look all that good. Hope you guys can see that. So it's all a lot of black spots. So this needs work, and as this is very difficult to get it done with normal Scotch Brite, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a small Dremel tool. This is an Inco, hope I'm spelling it right, Inco mini grinder. I got this from Amazon. Of course, almost all the products that I'm using for this I got from Amazon, except for the Scotch Brite pads, which are available locally. I'll have the links down in the description box below. You guys can get this. It's very useful for cleaning, polishing, and everything. And this one I got this separately. This is a nylon brush. This helps in cleaning a little hard to reach areas. There is even thinner one which helps in reaching even harder areas. So let's begin the work. There are multiple speeds, so I'm going to set at speed 3 and then begin the work and go up the intensity when the work gets more difficult. So let me put you in time lapse and we'll see the work getting done. So now this part is over. Actually, this part is not very important because does not face any fluid. This is just normal oxidization. This side is where your coil plate and magnet sits, and this side is usually sealed off. You don't want the dirt that's coming off the chain hitting here. So this side is sealed off like here. So, but the problem is this area anyways gets very dirty within the first 50 to 100 kilometers because of all the chain. I know it will be coming in so fast and turning and going back to the rear sprocket. So all that going and turning will cause all the dirt and grease to spray all over this place. And especially if it's raining, the mud and everything would be mixed. This place would be an entire mess within a very short time. Why I choose to do this, because it serves as a good practice platform before I go ahead, turn the case around and work on the actual insides. So that's why I started from here, so it will give me a good warm up and make sure that I'm not making any mistakes and stuff. So the next job is to turn this around and clean and polish the interior. We have to be very careful. We should not touch the bearing surfaces. We only have to clean everything else. All the bearing surfaces where the bearing sits, that's what I'm referring as bearing surfaces, they should not be touched. Especially they should not be touched with some sort of a Dremel. The best that we can do is we can simply use the Scotch Brite and do very gently. We have to clean it up. So other sides, I'm going to use the Dremel and I'm going to clean it up.
God bless the soul who invented this tool and who invented the Scotch Brite bits. It works really good and it's quite satisfying, to be honest.
Alright, so we've cleaned up and slightly removed all the unnecessary deposits from within the left side crankshaft, but as you guys can see, there's still a little bit of oxidization here. It's actually a lot, the camera is not able to catch it. So to get this removed, we have to polish it. This is called as a Scotch bit. So for all this time, I used this nylon brush bit. It's not that harsh on aluminum, but remember not to use it at very high speeds. It can damage the aluminum. So I used it at a low 3 to 4. I didn't go beyond that. This has about 6 speeds. Hope you guys can see the shine within the gearbox area. So we need to do that for the same here as well. Always remember not to touch the bearing surface. I repeat, not to touch the bearing surface with the Dremel. Things can go horribly wrong. So do not polish that. So let's just get this done. So I'm going to have my lunch break. So before I do that, I'm going to put the thinner on these oxidized areas. As you guys can see, the black spots. So what this does is it helps in loosening that rust up, and then I can again use the Dremel, refit another Scotch Brite pad, or I can even use this nylon brush, and then I can slowly try and remove it off. I can already see the rust starting to dissolve, and After my lunch, I can just simply come, rinse it, I mean, wipe it down, and then redo the process of polishing it up. Since most of the aluminum rust is down here, I am going to slightly tilt it so that the thinner liquid can settle beneath. So I am just going to use my something, I have my hand sanitizer here. I'm just going to place it right below, and the case can sit a little tilted upwards, so all the liquid, the thinner liquid will come down, and it can simply make sure that more of the rusted spot is actually submerged on the thinner. More of the thinner can actually touch that most rusted spots. So let me go have my lunch now, and then I'll be back and let's restart the process.
The next day.
Right, so I just got back after lunch. Before going with the Dremel tool, I'm going to try with this normal scotch brite pan. Really concentrate on that area and get it cleaned up. So let's get that done. Yeah, hope you guys can see that it already looks a lot better after the work. I'm just using a normal cloth, it's a microfiber towel to clean it up. And yeah, here's a new scotch brite bits. These things wear out pretty easily and they are not cheap as well, unfortunately. They are a little overpriced. Link is down in the description box below, but I think they are worth it for the extra price, because even though I feel they are overpriced, they do the job amazingly well. Check this out. Oh man, it looks a lot better. Of course, there are still a lot of black spots here and there, rather difficult to get them out, but I'm very happy with how it is. And this is from this was from the scrapyard, was in very bad shape, was probably submerged in a lot of crap, so that's why this looks so bad. Running bikes, especially if you dismantle engines, I don't think it is going to look this bad, but anyways, we never know, because we only get to know once we open up the engine and see. But anyways, I'm super happy with how the insides has come out. So next job is to polish the exterior. So we're going to get quite the similar same shine outside. So as you guys can see, all around all the sides. So let me get that done now. Same way, we're going to use the same scotch brite bits. Although we have to be very careful with this, because there is a lot of edges here and there. So this thing can wear out pretty quickly if you hit the edges, so we have to be very careful with that. And I have quite a load of these. I have some 50 of them, I guess.
I then polished the exterior of the crankcase to try and get a brushed aluminum finish from it. I used the same scotch brite bits. I feel they are overpriced, as I said before, but they do an awesome job.
Alright, so after 20 minutes of work, here is how the finished case looks like. So let's see the polished finish. Hope you guys can see that. Looks a lot better than what it used to be. Downside was all sorts of mud caked up. So looking at it, bare metal is super nice. Yeah, so this is your left side crankcase. It's been cleaned up, everything has been done. So once the gasket remover comes, I'll try using that product. I'll just put it all around the mating surface. As you guys can see, all around here there is still a little bit of gasket left there. It's even difficult to look from my eyes, let alone the camera. So I'll put that and try to clean it up once more time. But this is how the finished product looks like. Let's do a quick comparison between this one and the right side one, which I have already done off camera. So here is our left side crankcase, here is our right side crankcase. So this one I did off the camera, hope you guys can see that. So this one I was much more successful with removing the gasket material, and as you guys can see, I've also applied some gross anti-rust on top, and just so it will help in keeping this area safe. And then as you guys can see, I've also done the same polishing work on this one as well. Yeah, even here everything has been cleaned. So this is where our primary gear sits, this is where our clutch bell sits, here is your kick ratchet, and here is your idler gear, and so many things. So very amazing stuff. Here still some dirt is caked up, but I didn't bother too much with it. It was very difficult to clean, so, and it doesn't house any parts within, so I just let it like that. A little sad, but I'll probably get to it sometime later. So this is how our right side crankcase looks like. Yeah, likewise, even that is not perfect, even that has some small oxidizing marks on the aluminum, but again with the same technique I was able to reduce it drastically. Let me show you. I'll try and show you, I'm not sure if, yeah, hope you guys can see this one. Even the metal itself is damaged, but I was able to get rid of the rust. Quite took a long time, but yeah, I'm very happy with how it has turned out. And yeah, let's get back to the left side case. Here's where your gearbox, your gear shafts sit. Here's where your selector wheel sits. And here's where we'll put the neutral ball from on top of here. And yeah, and the gear selector lever shaft goes through here, as you guys can see my finger. So yeah, it looks awesome, especially after the polishing work. It looks really good. Yeah. So let me attach both the cases and let's take a look how it looks. I do not have the crankcase screws with me. I did not receive it in this from the scrapyard, but here is how it looks, as you guys can see.
Of course, I am very happy with how it has turned out, especially when comparing with how it had come home on the box with all that gunk and dirt. But it's not perfect, but hey, I am not expert in this. This was my first time trying this and I think I am successful. You guys can let me know down in the comment section below.
So the plan with this, again a lot of exciting stuff coming up. So if we take the, I took the right side one, hope you guys can see, this is our, where we drain our gearbox oil, transmission oil, some people call this the engine oil, it's not engine oil, this is your engine area, realistically speaking, literally speaking. The oil, they say 2T oil, this is the actual engine oil, it's a sealed unit, the oil that you pour here does not go to the gearbox, and the oil that you pour here saying engine oil does not get into the engine. It's a completely sealed unit. So coming back to the drain screw thing, as you guys can see, it's a complete mess. This has been broken. There are a lot of damages in this case, and the sad thing is it has been aluminum welded in such a very bad shape. So I have to redo this. I'll probably make a video for how to do this. So if you guys have cracked cases, thanks to some mechanics handling it like Bahubalis, it will be very useful. So that's it for this video, guys. I really enjoyed. I hope you guys enjoyed the process too. So if you did like it, do leave a like below. Do comment down your video suggestions and video requests on these bikes, technical stuff, or any queries and stuff. I shall definitely put my best efforts to get it done for you guys. As usual, thanks for watching. Do subscribe to the channel for more two-stroke content. Keep the blue smoke alive. Braddy Biker signing off. Have a wonderful day.